If you will, go ahead and turn to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. As you're turning there, let me mention, I always say this for anyone who may be visiting. I know Jerry mentioned it. Through the door on the right-hand side, there are outlines. And don't feel bad if you didn't get one. Go ahead and you can get up and walk back there and grab an outline. It will give you the majority of verses that I will use. I say the majority because I will add stuff as it comes to my memory. And I do use a lot of scripture, and so that's why we always make sure that it's there. Double check it, and please make sure that if you find any mistakes, let me know, and I will correct them from the pulpit. We don't make sure we don't make any mistakes here. We're going to look at an account today. If you notice on your bulletin there, on the outline, it says the woman used to test Jesus. Many of you are familiar with this account we're going to look at here in John 8. And I think many of us have read it, but I think there are some things we probably have overlooked as we've looked at this account. So if you will, let's go ahead and read the account first. If you follow along with me, I'm going to read John 8, verses 1 through 11, and then hopefully I can bring a few things to your mind that you may not have noticed before. Follow along with me, John 8, 1 through 11. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him. And he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery, in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? And this they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. And so when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and he wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. And when Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, No man, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Many of us are very familiar with this account. It's interesting that the enemies of Jesus, they often accused him of being a friend of publicans and sinners. Today, many will even say the same thing as they try to condone sin. And I began to think a little bit about another account of Jesus' words in dealing with some of the men that he was going to deal with in this account. I want you to listen to what Jesus says in Matthew 11, 16 through 19. And this is worded a little bit unusual, so I'm going to try to go back and render it a little bit different to help you out here. But Matthew 11, 16 through 19, listen to what he says. He says, But whereunto shall I liken this generation? How do I describe this generation? Specifically here, he's talking about the Jews and the Pharisees. He says, It's like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows. Let me pause for a second. We don't sit in markets and do this anymore, but how many of you as children used to call your friends to come get involved in your activities? You know, you want to play tag, you want to play basketball or baseball or football. Okay, it's kind of what he's describing there. And he says, and calling unto their fellows, verse 17, and saying, We've piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We've mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented. His point was, well, we called you, we tried to get you involved in what it is that we were doing, but you guys didn't do that. Now notice exactly what he says after this in verse 18. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he hath a devil. He says, you guys are trying to get everybody else to get involved in your activity. And then you say, you know, John here, he didn't come eating and drinking. We know that. John was a Nazirite, right? John wasn't involved in eating and drinking. He wouldn't have been involved in many of the social environments they would have been involved in because he was a Nazirite. Okay? And so he wouldn't have partook in that. As a matter of fact, he was out in the wilderness. And so he doesn't get involved in the things they're doing for a number of reasons. And they say, he hath the devil. John the Immerser, he's got a demon. He's crazy. He's a madman. And then they go on and listen to what they say about Jesus. The Son of Man came eating and drinking. Now, Jesus wasn't a Nazirite, and Jesus did come eating and drinking. As a matter of fact, we know a number of times where Jesus went to some of these events that were taking place. And notice what they say about him. Behold, a man gluttonous and a wine bibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. I find it interesting, John the Baptist didn't come eating and drinking, and they say he has a demon. Jesus says, now I do come eating and drinking. I'm involved with these people, and you say I'm a gluttonous and a wino. You tell them people I've got an alcoholic or a problem with alcoholism. Well, neither one of those were true. Why do I bring all this up? Well, the Pharisees and the scribes were often trying to get other people to fall in line with what it was that they were doing. He mentions here, it doesn't matter whether we do what you're doing or what we're not involved in what you're doing. You're going to find some reason to find fault with us. Most of us with wisdom are going to exonerate the conduct of both John the Immerser, Jesus, the apostles or the disciples. We know John the Immerser wasn't crazy. We know that Jesus was not a wine bibber, as they call him. We know that he didn't fellowship sin. But with all that being said, let me say this. There are many accounts which record our Lord and Savior, and you know he spent time with? Guess who he spent time with? He spent time with people who were sinners. He did. But let me tell you this, he wasn't fellowshipping sin. Jesus had a reason why he spent time with these people. Many of the accounts we have involve him spending time with these people. And today we're going to look at just one of those accounts. As a matter of fact, Jesus didn't even go out of his way to get involved in this situation. This situation was brought to him. And you're going to find out why here in just a minute. Because many know the account, but they don't understand why it even took place. So let's try to get a little bit of an understanding about what's happening here. First, let's go back and let's look a little bit at the aspects of this. First, the setting. Well, we know that it starts off here in the temple court. Okay, we know that it was early in the morning. What we have is our Lord and Savior who is sitting there and he's teaching. There is a large crowd. They've gathered together. They're listening to our Lord and our Savior teach. And all of a sudden, the Jewish leaders, the scribes and the Pharisees, they drag a woman literally into his presence. And they drag her into his presence and they demand that Jesus will place a verdict on her. Now, Jesus is just sitting there teaching. He's not trying to cause any issue. But they have determined that they're going to bring this woman to Jesus. Now, let's look a little bit at the characters here. We see what's taking place. Jesus is simply teaching, and now all of a sudden a group of men have dragged a woman into his presence, and they want Jesus to condemn her or to say, let her go. Well, first we see involved in this account are the scribes and the Pharisees. The scribes were experts in the law. They are people that we would probably refer to today as the lawyers. They knew the law through and through. So if you had a problem or a question regarding the law, you would go to the lawyers, the scribes. You also see here are the Pharisees. We know a little bit about the Pharisees. They were the more strict of the Jewish sects. If you've not studied the groups, they had, in essence, multiple groups under Judaism, just like you find today in Christendom. And so you had those who were the Sadducees, the Pharisees, you had Essenes, you had other groups. But the Pharisees were the more strict of the Jews, okay? Their rendering of the law was often more accurate, but they had another problem, and the problem was oftentimes they would bring in things that weren't in the law. And so what I mean by that is oftentimes they had the idea of legalism. They were very religious men, often in high powers, powerful positions, but the problem was they would often also bind things that were not in the law. That wasn't their only problem, but it was one of their problems. Now, as we consider what's taking place here, I want you to notice about these men. These men, as they drag this woman up, I want you to understand real quick, they didn't have any mercy for this woman. They didn't care about her lost soul. They could have cared less what happened to that woman. There was no compassion. As a matter of fact, they could have cared less what the verdict was even placed on her. They're using her as a pawn in a chess match against our Lord and Savior. That's what's going on. They want to find a way to get to Jesus, and so they're using this woman. Now, ask yourself, why are they even demanding a verdict from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? You've got the scribes. They're the lawyers. They understand the law through and through. And you've got the Pharisees. They knew the law. And they bring this woman and ask yourself, why are they bringing her to Jesus and asking for a verdict? They actually tell Jesus what the law states. You ever read this and wondered why they would even bring her there? They said, the law states, and they tell him. They weren't trying to help restore this woman in a sinful condition. That's not what was going on. They're trying to tempt Jesus. This happens a number of times. They are oftentimes trying to tempt Jesus. Let me give you a similar example, because in this example here, Jesus, he becomes very angry. He becomes extremely angry at the hardness of their hearts. They had some serious spiritual problems. Listen to Mark 3:5 at this example. "And when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, Stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other." Now, this woman in the account we're looking at today, she needed spiritual restoration, right? She needed some spiritual help. In this account I just read, Mark 3:5, you got a guy whose hand is withered. He needs physical help. And they're upset that Jesus is healing people on the Sabbath. I can't believe he would do that. Why is he healing people on the Sabbath? They ought to have been worried about the guy's hand, right? Wow, they should have been thrilled that Jesus just restored this man's hand. But no, they want to find a reason to find fault with our Lord and Savior. You ever known anybody today that wants to do that with our Lord and Savior? They want to find fault with Him, or they want to find fault with His Word? Well, the Pharisees, they were very often zealous. They would bind the law on others and themselves, and so they had a lot of issues. Notice Matthew 23:4. "For they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers." It's interesting. Noah actually used the verse during the Lord's Supper. I think he comes over and goes through my notes at my house during the week on what I'm preaching on. 1 John 5:3 says, God's commands are not grievous. They're not burdensome. It's interesting because in Matthew 23:4, he says the Pharisees' laws, they are burdensome. Well, I know that the Pharisees' laws then are not God's laws, because God's laws are not burdensome. They're not grievous. They're not meant to harm us. They're meant to protect us. It's funny, you begin to study the Bible with somebody and they'll say, I don't like that law. I don't like what that says to do. And it's like, it's in here to help you protect yourself, not only from the world, but really from yourself, and also from being in a situation where you're not righteous in God's sight. It's interesting that what the Pharisees do, Christians oftentimes will do. They're constantly finding faults with other people, and yet they have their own issues that they need to work through. I'm not suggesting we shouldn't try to help people. That's not what I'm saying. But Jesus, he dealt with this in Matthew 7. You remember, he said, hey, you're over there trying to get the splinter out of your buddy's eye, right? And he said, you've got a big old mote or a beam in your own eye. Why don't you work on that problem first before you try to help somebody else that's got a problem? That's the Pharisees. They're in this situation and they don't even know it yet. He's going to let them know, but they don't know it yet. And so the men in this account, they're acting as judges. And here's the thing. They're in a lost condition, just like the woman that they just dragged before Jesus. And Jesus is going to let them know they're in a lost condition, just as he's going to let the woman know she was in a lost condition. He's not going to let either one of them walk away without letting them understand the truth. That's true love right there, isn't it? That's our Lord and Savior. Does it mean that you're going to like what he has to say? Absolutely not, but he's going to let them know. And so we've looked at the scribes and the Pharisees, but we also know we've got then our Lord and Savior. We have Christ. He was the friend of publicans and sinners, not like the Pharisees accused him of, not like many today would try to suggest. Here's what we know about Jesus. He offered grace and mercy and forgiveness. He did, but we know that it was always conditional, and I'll show you that here in a second. He was the sinless Son of God. We know that he was the teacher of true religion, of true morality. He was the one who was trying to bring the lost back to the truth. Many times the words that he spoke were just as hard to hear as the words of John the Immerser. He used a very straightforward approach. You find that from a number of teachers in the Bible. Paul did the same thing. Peter did the same thing. Stephen did the same thing. They killed him for it. The list goes on and on. Words of love can oftentimes be mingled with words of straightforward truth. We find it oftentimes, and Jesus didn't shy away from that. It's funny that John the Immerser and Jesus, you know, they were both able to go out and they were able to convert sinners. But you know who they oftentimes couldn't convert? The Pharisees. It's funny, the sinners, the people who knew that they had a problem, they came to John the Immerser and Jesus willingly, and they were excited and glad to hear them. The Pharisees, however, were not. Jesus actually gives us a parable and he explains it. It had to have been hard for them to hear this. Listen to what he says, Matthew 21:28-32, as he tries to get them to understand they've got a problem and they don't even know it. He says, "But what think ye? A certain man had two sons, and he came to the first, and he said, Son, go work today in my vineyard. And he answered and said, I will not. But afterward he repented and went. And he came to the second, and he said, Likewise. And he answered and said, I go, sir, and went not. Whither of them twain did the will of the Father? Jesus asked him, Which one did the will of the Father? They say unto him, The first. Now notice what Jesus says. Jesus saith unto them, Verily, I say unto you, that the publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and ye believed him not. But the publicans and the harlots believed him, and ye, when ye had seen it, repented not afterward that ye might believe him. Did you hear what he just told them? That had to have been extremely hard for them to hear. Here was his point. The publicans and the harlots, they know they're sinners. They know they need spiritual help. And they come openly. But you guys, who also have a problem, you just don't get it. Have you guys ever noticed that people who often seek out wanting to find information here, there are people who have nowhere else to go. You want to know why I sought out the Bible? I was a horrible person before I was a Christian. I had nowhere else to go. I had nowhere else to go. So where do we go when we get to that point? We're the same people like these harlots and these sinners. We have nothing else left. Jesus knew it. He knew it and he understood it and he told them. And these men who are religious, these Pharisees, they couldn't get it. They just couldn't get it. And so he says the harlots and the publicans, they're going to go into the kingdom before you. In the religious world today, there are many who realize they are lost. There are a lot. There are many people who realize they need to find salvation. Some don't know how. Some have just been taught wrong. They just don't know. And there are other people out in the religious world today who think that they're saved. They've been taught something, and then when they hear the truth, they may disagree with it. I want you to understand, I honestly feel sorry for those who have been taught a lie, especially when they're sincere and they're looking for the truth. But there are a lot of people today who understand they're lost. These Pharisees here, they had no clue. They dragged the woman in front of him, but they themselves don't realize that they're lost. I want you to notice the woman in this account. She was a sinner. She was. Matter of fact, we know that she, from this account, was guilty of adultery. And here's even worse. Under the law of Moses, the penalty for what she had done was her to be stoned to death. Okay? That's a pretty harsh penalty. Am I saying it wasn't justified? Certainly the law of Moses told how to deal with people like that, and there was a reason why. It was to try to get them to not be involved in these things. Listen to what the law states, because I want us to make an understanding of why these men, as they're tempting Jesus, they know the law. I want you to understand what they're basing it on. Deuteronomy 22, 21 and 22. Then they shall bring out the damsel to the door of her father's house, and the men of her city shall stone her with stones that she die, because she hath wrought folly in Israel to play the whore in her father's house. So shalt thou put evil away from among you. And if a man be found lying with a woman married to an husband, then they shall, notice this, they shall both of them die, both the man that lay with the woman and the woman. So shalt thou put away evil from Israel. The whole point was, let's make the penalty so severe that people just won't do it. You think people, though, just won't do it because you make a severe penalty? We have laws against all kinds of stuff in this nation, right? What happens if you rob a bank or if you shoot somebody? There's all kinds of laws. Does that stop people necessarily? It is a deterrent, but it doesn't stop people. And so we have an understanding here. Both the woman and the man, they're guilty from this account. Now, there's another passage we go to, and I'm going to mention it because of the man here. Leviticus 20, 10 through 13. And the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. And the man that lieth with his father's wife hath uncovered his father's nakedness, both of them shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. And if a man lie with his daughter-in-law, both of them shall surely be put to death. They have wrought confusion. Their blood shall be upon them. And if a man also lie with mankind, as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. Now, I hope you're not in there saying, Sean, are you suggesting that that's how we treat people today? Absolutely not. That's under the law of Moses. We're going to see a distinction here in a minute. That's under the law of Moses. But here's my whole point. They've just drugged this woman in front of Jesus and said, here's what the law states. And then they said, what do you say, Jesus? Ask yourself why they're even asking him that. Okay? I'm not suggesting she wasn't guilty. Here's what I'm suggesting. They didn't care. They didn't care whether she was guilty or not. They're going to use her simply to try and tempt our Lord and Savior. Now, I also find it very interesting. It's very unlikely that she would have been caught in the act unless maybe this was set up, or I don't really know exactly what happened. But have you guys ever noticed who's missing in this account so far? Where's the man at? I just read the law. But they said she's caught in the very act. In the very act. So wait a minute. So if she was caught in the very act, guess who else was there? The man. Do we read about him in this account at all? Why does he get off? Where's he at? That's a good question. I wish I had the answer to that. The Bible doesn't tell us. And so I can't give you an opinion on it. I'm not going to speak where the Bible doesn't speak. But I'm curious. Something smells fishy here. You got the woman. You caught her in the act, but the man's not here. So, this woman has a soul. This woman, she was a sinner. This woman, though, was a prospect for conversion. I want you guys to remember this. Some of the people you're going to come in contact with, they're going to be horrible people who are involved in horrible sins. But you know what? I want you to understand this. They are prospects for conversion. How many of you were perfect before you became a Christian? How many of you messed up big time in your life before you became a Christian? Most of us know somebody. I have friends, personal friends, men I rely on and think greatly of, who were meth addicts, drug dealers, gang members, adulterers. The list goes on and on, and those men are out preaching the gospel. You know why? Because at one time they were prospects for conversion, and somebody could overlook the fact that they appeared to the world to be a worthless individual, but understand that in Christ's eyes, these people could be somebody. We gotta change the way we think about people. I don't condone their acts. I don't like to see them involved in it, but you know what? They could be a Christian. Some of the guys I've known who were not Christians and were horrible people, they are some of the hardest working people for the name of Christ right now that I know of. They're out trying to teach. Now, let's consider the plot here. Read along with me in John 8, 3 through 6. You'll get an understanding of what's going on. And the scribes and the Pharisees, they brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, don't you notice, they drag her over to him. They say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now, notice this. These are the scribes and the Pharisees. They know what's going on here and what the punishment is. Now, Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? And this they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, and with his finger he wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. Their goal wasn't to determine whether she was guilty or not. They already knew she was guilty. They said, we just caught her in the act. And so they knew the law. They wanted to try and find a way to condemn Jesus. Here's what they thought they were doing. They thought they were going to force Jesus to take a position. Either he's going to agree with the Jews and the Jewish system, or he's going to agree with the Roman system that's in place at the time. Now, you may not understand it yet, but I'm going to explain it to you. So here's, in essence, what they did. They asked him a question, and either way he answers the question, it's like this: we got you. It'd be like me saying, hey, Jerry, have you quit beating your wife lately? Have you quit beating her? Well, if he answers it yet, and Jerry doesn't beat his wife, let me just say that. But if he answers yes, then it infers that he's previously been beating his wife. But if he says no, it means he's still beating his wife. Whether he says yes or no, gotcha, right? That's what they're doing to Jesus here. Either way you answer it, we gotcha. So here's the whole thing. If Jesus says go ahead and condemn her, which they've already said, this is what the law of Moses says. If Jesus says that, then they're going to go to the Romans, they're going to say, Jesus, this teacher over here, he says condemn her, and he says that we're supposed to stone her. Here's the problem. The Jews at this time, they didn't have the right to stone anybody. They did at one time, they don't now. The Romans are in authority, and so the Romans will determine if somebody is killed or not. They can give you permission to do it, but you can't just go do it. Okay? When this change actually was taken away from the Jews and they lost that ability and Rome took it over, we don't know the exact date, but we know it from John 18, 31. Then said Pilate unto them, take ye him and judge him according to your law. You go take Jesus and kill him. Notice what they said. The Jews therefore said unto him, it is not lawful for us to put any man to death. Well, the law of Moses told them that they could put people to death, but under this time, the Romans were in authority. It's funny, the Jews said, we've never been in bondage to anyone. Yes, you were. The Romans tell you what you can and can't do. And so they couldn't kill this woman, and they also couldn't kill our Lord and Savior, but they could use this woman as a pawn to try to get to our Lord and Savior. They could use her to try to have the Roman system put him to death. Jesus was fairly smart. If Jesus says don't condemn her, he's violating the law of Moses. If Jesus says do condemn her, they're gonna accuse him of setting aside the law of Moses. You don't even follow the law of Moses, and here you are teaching people, right? So they think they got him. No matter what you say, we've got you. They're setting a trap for him. They're trying to ruin his credibility amongst the people. They're actually trying to judge Jesus, not the woman. They could have cared less about that woman. I'll be honest, I feel bad for her in the situation she's in. You notice you don't even hear her talk or say anything. Do you even hear her defending herself for what she's done? It's interesting. We don't get any of that information. She's just being used for their purpose. This is very similar to Matthew 22:17. They tried to do this to Jesus all the time. Notice Matthew 22:17. Tell us therefore, what thinkest thou? Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? Just like the question of, hey, Jerry, have you quit beating your wife yet? Yes or no? Either way you answer it, we got you, right? If he says yes, he loses favor amongst the people because people hate paying taxes to Rome. So he can't say pay taxes to Rome. But if he says don't pay your taxes to Rome, you know what they're going to do? They're going to go to the Roman government and say, this guy's causing civil unrest and saying we don't have to pay taxes to you. They think they got him either way. Notice how Jesus, he's going to defuse this situation, John 8:6-9. This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, and with his finger he wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself, and he said unto them, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down, and he wrote on the ground, and they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. I laugh every time I read this. Jesus, he stoops down. Just imagine, he stoops down. They're talking to him. What do you say, Jesus? Do we condemn her or not condemn her? And he starts writing. It says here that he's writing as he heard them not. It's like when I talk to my dog, and the dog, I know she hears me, and she doesn't even look at me. 3 blocks away, a wrapper from a piece of cheese gets moved, and she's looking around. So Jesus is doing the same thing. He hears it, but he just keeps on doing what he's doing, right? As if he heard them not. He then gives them a challenge. I'll paraphrase it for you. You best check yourself. He says, you best check yourself. The King James words it a little bit different. He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. Jesus here is changing the very situation by putting them in a dilemma. He's not going to let them. They think they've got one pulled over on him, but Jesus, he's not going to let them get by with it. Jesus, he's going to put them in a dilemma. Jesus, he's going to use their trick against them. I want you to notice Matthew 21:23-27. Jesus was masterful at using their own tricks against them. Here's another account where he does it. And when he was coming to the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people, they came unto him as he was teaching, and they said, by what authority doest thou these things? And who gave thee this authority? And Jesus answered and said unto them, I will also ask you one thing, which if you tell me, I and likewise will tell you by what authority I do these things. He says, the baptism of John, whence was it? From heaven or of men? And they, notice they go off. They reasoned with themselves, saying, well, if we shall say from heaven, he'll say unto us, why did ye not then believe him? But if we shall say of men, we fear the people, for all hold that John as a prophet. And they answered Jesus and said, well, we cannot tell. And he said unto them, neither tell I you by what authority I do these things. See, Jesus did the same thing to them. Was John a prophet? If they said no, the people were going to rise up because they knew that John the Immerser was a prophet. So they couldn't say no. But if they say yes, Jesus is going to go, then why didn't you listen to him? He preached to you openly. Why didn't you listen to him? So either way, they knew they were, Jesus, he did their same trick on them. So they just said this, well, we can't answer you. He said, well, then I'm not going to answer you either. Notice how masterful that trick is being used in our Lord and Savior's hands. Now, in this account, he begins to write. Now, it's interesting that their consciences are convicted. Ask yourself, was it because of what he had already said to them about casting a stone, or was it because of what he wrote? I've read some scholars who said Jesus was writing out their sins, and Jesus was... We have no idea what Jesus was writing. The Bible doesn't tell us that. And so to go any further would be to draw conclusions that the Bible doesn't give us. But I do know that he's writing something. I don't know what it is. That's one of the first questions I got. When I get to heaven, one of the first things I'm asking, what was Jesus writing in the... What was going on there? I want to know. Okay? Because the commentaries I read from the scholars here on earth, they don't really give me any verses to back it up. Okay? But I know this. Notice the older men left first. How many of you as men can go back when you were 18 years old and you ask yourself today how it is you are still alive? I've asked myself, how in the world did I live to get to the age that I'm at now? I should be dead. I made some pretty dumb mistakes. I made an awful lot of bad decisions. You ever notice that oftentimes with age comes wisdom? Why is it oftentimes when we have a problem, we go find an older person that's dealt with it? If I'm having a struggle with something and I can't figure it out, you know who I call? I call an older preacher. Maybe he's dealt with it. Here in this account, the older men are leaving first, okay? Why? Well, somebody with a correctly instructed conscience, they're going to be affected very deeply. You see an example of that in Acts 2:37. Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart. This is after Peter's just preaching the gospel to them, saying, "You just killed our Lord and Savior." And notice what it says. And they said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" See, he convicted their conscience. And so they wanted to deal with it. Acts 7:54, he got the same thing. Stephen goes out, he preaches the gospel. They were convicted, but guess what they did? Instead of obeying the gospel, they just killed him. So sometimes when people's consciences are convicted, here's what happens. Sometimes they hear the word and they're going to be obedient. Sometimes you'll convict their conscience and they'll say, "I'm not going to do it," and they're going to rage. They're going to rage upon the machine, basically, is what's going to happen. They're going to bring up wrath, okay? You could get either one of those responses. Here, luckily, when Jesus tells them to check themselves, and he uses it in the sense of throwing a stone, you've got the older men beginning to leave first. The younger men, guess what? And let's remember this with congregations. The older men led way with wisdom, and guess who followed? The younger men followed. We got problems in congregations. You know how oftentimes that's resolved? The older men with wisdom lead forward, and guess who will fall in line? The younger men who maybe do not have so much wisdom. Okay? That's what's taking place here. And so we need to check ourselves, take an honest look at ourselves, and we need to say, is my conscience, is it calibrated? Is it based or is it in alignment with God's word? Because I certainly can't be right with God if I'm not doing what it is that God wants me to do. 2 Corinthians 13:5. Examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. We're talking about the faith, the gospel system, the New Testament. That's what the faith is. We're not talking about a mental ascent here, okay? You can understand that from the word the. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you? He's in me. Unless what? Except you be reprobates. He's in you while you're a faithful Christian. It's interesting that people talk about the Holy Spirit being in them. You ever hear people talking about Jesus being in them? You ever hear people talking about God being in them? The Scriptures teach that God is in us, the Holy Spirit is in us, Jesus is in us. How are they in us? They are in us through the written word. And the fruits of those who are in Christ, the Holy Spirit, and God will be evident in their life. Some have used this saying. How many have ever heard this? Some have used this saying. Yeah, well, let the first one without sin throw the first stone. How many of you ever heard that? You ever heard it? How many of you live under the law of Moses? Has anybody ever had a woman drug into their presence and said, "Hey, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. We need to stone her. You want to be in?" Do we do that today? Did I miss something? Why are people using that verse to say, "Well, if you're without sin, you throw the first"? We don't stone people today. You know what we do today? We compel and encourage people to repent and fall in alignment with the New Testament. We don't throw stones at people. Matter of fact, we're commanded. 2 Timothy 4:2. Notice this. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Notice this. Reprove, that's a command. Rebuke, that's a command. Exhort, with all longsuffering and doctrine, that's a command. But I am not commanded to throw stones at anybody. So why is it Christians today will say, you know, if you don't have any sin, you'd be the first one to throw a stone. First of all, we don't throw stones today. And as a matter of fact, when you begin to talk about judging people, we're told to judge in righteous judgment. And Jesus dealt with it. Why don't you quit worrying about that splinter in your brother's eye and you get that big old mote out of your eye? Work on that problem first and work with me here for a second, guys. So I got a big old mote in my eye. How in the world am I supposed to pull the splinter out of someone else's eye when my eye is it's completely closed? I can't see out of it in the first place. I couldn't even help my brother if I wanted with big motes in my eyes. That's what Jesus was saying. Deal with yourself and then you can help somebody else. So, look at Jesus' conversation with the woman, and I'll draw this to a close. Although, when I say that, this still means I got 10 more minutes. Notice what he says in John 8, 10 through 11. When Jesus had lifted up himself and he saw none but the woman, he said unto her, woman, let me pause for a minute. When he says woman, that's not a root. Today, that's, if my son were to come up to my wife and say, woman, he would get drugged by the back of the neck through the house. In the first century, that is a term of endearment. It's like lady, ma'am. So let me change my inflection on it. Instead of saying woman, he says, woman, where are those thine accusers? Where are the people at who are accusing you? Hath no man condemned thee? She said, no man, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Was Jesus saying, hey, you got a free pass on this one? Yeah, just don't get caught next time. Yeah, that's not what's going on either. You got people today that will try to infer that. That's not what's taking place here. We get a glimpse here of the difference between the law of Moses and New Testament Christianity. I want you guys to remember this. Jesus came to save men's lives, not to destroy them. Have you guys ever known somebody that hated, literally hated people because they were, and I'm just going to throw some out there right off the top of my head. You ever known somebody that hated somebody because they believed and did false they believed false teachings about religion, or because maybe they had a sinful lifestyle. Maybe they were, let's just say it, maybe they were a homosexual, or maybe they were involved in an inappropriate marriage, or the list goes on and on. You ever known people that literally hated people like that? There's actually a group out there, I'll say their name, Westboro Baptists that literally go out and say that homosexual, they say all kinds of horrible, mean things. Things I've never seen before. And they say they're doing it in the name of Christ. I want you guys to remember this. Christ came to save men's souls, not to destroy them. Do I condone what those people do? Absolutely not. I want all those sinful people to sit in this building with us and quit doing those things and be saved and go to heaven with me. I don't condone it. And Jesus didn't either, right? I want you to notice, Jesus one time, he sent messengers to Samaria. You guys may recall this account. He sends his disciples into Samaria. He says, hey, prepare the city for me. I'm coming. Okay? And when they get there, the Samaritans say, not going to happen. I mean, we don't want Jesus coming down here and teaching. And listen to what is said. And when his disciples, James and John, this is Luke 9, 54 through 56. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? Think about that for a minute. Lord, you want us to command fire to come down and kill the entire city because they've rejected you? Can you imagine that thought process? That is messed up. That's as messed up as me hating somebody for their sin when I should want them to come to salvation, right? Notice what Jesus says. But he turned and rebuked them and said, ye know not what manner of spirit ye are of, for the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. How could he come back later and even teach those people the truth if they killed them all? You ever thought about that? James and John's first thought process was, let's kill them, because they don't believe what we believe. They're not in alignment with us, so let's just kill them because they're different. That's one of the most messed up things I've ever heard. Jesus, he converted James and John. And it's interesting that John, you guys know what John was called before he was a disciple? He was a son of thunder. How many of you probably were described as sons of thunder before you were a Christian? I should have got beat all the time. I was about as wild as they come. And my daughter asked, when did boys grow up? And I said, I was like 35, so it's going to happen one day. When? I don't know. And it varies. Some men never grow up. Some women never grow up. And some of us, it takes losing an awful lot before we do. Jesus converted a son of thunder, and guess what he became known though? The disciple of love. The apostle of love. Matter of fact, you go back and you read what he had to say. He changed his mindset. You know what he changed? He went away from that mindset of, let's just kill them, to why don't we love them? And part of that love, though, is teaching them the truth. Fine, I'll say it. I was thinking this week a lot about this. The messed up mindset of Christians today. You know how many times in the last couple of months I have seen people say, you know, if somebody were to ever come into my house, or if I were ever in a store and somebody came in and they were robbing the store, see, I'm a concealed carry. I'm just gonna kill them. I'm gonna shoot them. You guys, how many of you seen it on Facebook? I've seen ministers posting it. If I'm ever confronted with somebody, I'm gonna kill them. Why don't you stop for a second? That is the most messed up mindset I have ever heard. That I'm gonna premeditate before an event even happens. That when it happens, I'm gonna kill them. Now, I hope nobody ever breaks into my house, but I will tell you this. I hope I never have to point a weapon at somebody. And I was an avid hunter. I'm very good. I hope I never have to point a weapon at somebody. My first mindset's not, I'm just going to kill people. How do I teach somebody the gospel when I kill them? How? How do I premeditate in my mind before an event even happens? That's how I'm going to deal with a situation. But I see it on Facebook all the time from Christians. Not only from Christians, from ministers who say, if this event ever happens, they've premeditated in their mind, I will kill that person. You mean like the sons of thunder who wanted to destroy men instead of saving them? And Jesus said, I came to save men's lives, not to destroy them. We as Christians, we do this in a lot of ways. You know how we do it? You know another way we do it? We don't teach people the gospel because you know what? We don't like them. I don't like that person. They live a sinful life, and I know it. And I don't think they're worthy of the gospel, so I'm not going to teach them the gospel. That's wrong. That's wrong. We do it in a whole lot of ways. I'm just mentioning, imagine the mindset of Christians who determine either to totally reject somebody because of what they believe or what they do, or premeditate in their mind how they'll even deal with something. I hope I never have to deal with a situation like that. And let me say this without going any further. I'm not preaching and teaching complete pacifism. I've never believed that. But I'll tell you this, my first mindset is never, I'll just kill them. That's just messed up. As Christians, we are to love people. We are to draw them to Christ. I've actually heard of accounts where people have broken into houses with weapons, and the people there just sat and talked with them before they rushed to the conclusion of shooting. And they had weapons. They didn't shoot them. I'm not saying that they may not have had to have done that, but they tried to find a different way first. Okay? I'm getting tired of some of the messed up mindsets I see from Christians. That's just not okay. And so you begin to think about the sons of thunder who they wanted to call fire down on these people. And Jesus said, what are you thinking? Now, here's the interesting thing. You've got those disciples there who want to call down fire. And you know what their response would have been? They deserve it. They deserve it. That's the same response you get when someone says, well, if they break into my house, I'm going to kill them. Because guess what? They deserve it. When they drug this woman in front of Jesus, who was a sinner, did Jesus say, let's stone her, she deserves it? You notice the difference from the old law to the new law? Jesus wanted to save people, not kill them. He didn't want to destroy their lives. Notice the difference. His first thought was, yeah, she's getting what she's got coming. His first thought was, what can we do to save her? Jesus didn't come to condemn or judge the world during his ministry. Let me say that again so you get this. Jesus didn't come to judge or condemn the world during his ministry. John 3:17, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. John 3:17. John 12:47, and if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. But I'm not suggesting that sin is acceptable or condoned. You know why? Because even though Jesus didn't come to condemn or judge the world during his ministry, he will come back to condemn and to judge. 2 Thessalonians 1:6-9. Notice what it says. Seeing it is a righteous thing with God to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you, and to you who are troubled, rest with us. When the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His power. And so we'll be judged according to the Word, but check this out. Jesus, He came and He taught and He gave us the truth, but He hasn't condemned and judged us yet, because guess how long we have? Either till we die in that situation or until He comes back. He's given us time. Why? Because He came to save men's souls, not to destroy them. We all of us that are here right now, we ought to be blessed that we're still alive, because we can either obey the gospel or we can repent. We still have time. Okay? Jesus didn't want people to be destroyed. And so there's a lot that we can understand here. Jesus, He told this woman, go and sin no more. Jesus didn't say, hey, you got away with this one, so live it up. That's the mentality of the world around us. Do unto others and then cut out, right? Let's live it up. I got away with this one. Jesus didn't tell her. They said, go and sin no more. You got religious people that'll say, well, it doesn't even matter if you sin anymore in the future, because once you've been saved, you've always been saved. Jesus must not have known that by inspiration here, because He didn't teach that. Jesus said, go and sin no more. What do we learn from that? If we're involved in sin, we need to stop it. Now, there are a lot of people who think, and I hate to say this, but I'm going to mention it. There are a lot of people who think that baptism, when they become a Christian, they think it solves all your problems. I was listening to GBN the other day, and they were having an open forum, and a lady called, and I was heartbroken when she called. She called and she said, I'm a member of the church, and I have a question. She said, my husband always left me. He left me a bunch of times, and you know what? I got tired of it, so I divorced him, and I found a good man, and I married him. And she said, I want to know, can I still be married to this man? Because, see, I got baptized. She said, I got baptized and became a Christian. And I'm so thankful there was a faithful gospel preacher there that said, the Bible teaches. He didn't say, yes, no. He said, the Bible teaches. And he said, do you have a Bible, ma'am? And he said, go to Matthew 19, 1 through 9. And he read it. And then he said, we have an example of what just happened that you talked about in 1 Corinthians 7. And he read it and he said, ma'am, I hate to tell you this, and I'm glad that you're sincere and you're asking, but no. You cannot continue to live with that man that you now call your husband. And she said, but he's a good man. And I'm sure that he was. Why didn't the preacher that baptized her teach her all that beforehand? Because how does she live faithful in God's sight when she's continuing to live in sin as a Christian? You ever heard someone say, well, you can have been married 100 times, but when you get baptized, it fixes the problem. Here's the problem with that, guys. Matthew 19, 1 through 9 makes it very clear, you can't do that. And every time, I'll be as gentle as I can say this, every time that a husband and wife is intimate together in an unapproved marriage, that's adultery. It doesn't matter. If I got baptized and it cleansed my sins, which it would, every time I'm in that act again, I commit adultery again and again and again and again. You know how I stop committing adultery? I quit doing that act with the person that I'm not allowed to do that act with. Baptism doesn't just wash away sins and give you a free get-out-of-jail card like you get in Monopoly. But some of the religious world around us, they think that. Notice Colossians 3, 5 through 10, and then I'll actually stop. I could go for another hour. I want to. I'm so excited to preach today, but I can't. Colossians 3, 5 through 10 says, mortify therefore your members, which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. For which things' sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. There's going to be wrath because of these things. Notice what he says. In the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them. How many of you lived in some of those before you were Christians? Right? That's what he's telling them. He says, but now ye also put off all these anger and wrath and malice and blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. That means don't be using euphemisms and putting OMG on Facebook and using inappropriate language. Quit doing that. We know that it happens. It's wrong. He says, and lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds. Check this out. And put on the new man. You're not like that anymore. You don't do those things anymore, because when you get washed in the blood of Christ, you don't do those things anymore. And so you can't remain in some of those sinful situations. Very clearly. He says, which is renewed in knowledge. How? By the word of God. After the image of him that created him. Jesus was the friend of, I'll draw it to a close, Jesus was the friend of publicans and sinners, not like the religious world today tries to claim. His goal was to save sinners, not to destroy them. Our goal as Christians is to save people out in the world. I don't hate anybody. I have never, since I've become a Christian, I have never hated anyone. I didn't hate them before I was a Christian, but as Christians, I'll just say this is wrong. I've never hated somebody because of their skin color. Can't even imagine it. I've never hated somebody because of their gender or their nationality. I can't even imagine it. When people ask, is your group, your congregation diverse? Had somebody ask me that. You know what I said? Well, we're all red because we're covered in the blood of Christ. And I said, there is not one person in our congregation that I'm aware of, and we wouldn't condone it, who's bias or prejudice. That's wrong. And I don't hate anybody out in the world who's not a Christian yet, because you know what? There was a time when I wasn't a Christian. There was a time. And I didn't live right. I'll just tell you that. And somebody loved me enough to push me to study the Bible. Somebody believed in me. Do you believe in those people out there who aren't saved yet? What will you do to help them? And if you're a Christian today, will you be faithful? If you're here and you're not a Christian, let me tell you very quickly what the Bible teaches. And I'm not going to give you my opinion at all. Here's what the Bible teaches. You want to be a follower of God? It's as simple as this. In every conversion account, somebody was teaching the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Peter did it there in Acts chapter 2 as he was preaching to the Jews. And so we understand that there was people going around, they were just teaching the gospel. Jesus was the Messiah. He shed his blood. And guess what? He was resurrected from the dead so you can have the hope of eternal life. When people believed what was being taught, they obeyed the gospel. Okay? Romans 10, 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. You've got to hear the gospel so you can believe it. But when they believed that he was the Messiah, they were willing to obey. Hebrews 11, 6 and John 8, 24. Okay, and so when they heard it, they knew, I'm a sinner, and so I need to repent of my sins. Why? Because Jesus commanded it. Luke 13, 3, he said, nay, I tell you, except you repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Same thing in Acts 17, 30. So now that you believe that I am Jesus Christ, the Son of God, you must repent. That was a command from Jesus. Do you guys believe Jesus? She's coming forward right now for the repentance. You guys believe Jesus? Jesus said you need to repent of your sins. We're also told that we have to confess Jesus before men. Matthew 10, 32 and 33. Also Romans 10, 9 and 10. And so I understand now that Jesus was the Messiah, I understand that I have to repent because of my belief in that, and I know that I'm a sinner. I need to confess Jesus before men, and guess what I also know? Jesus commanded, He commanded that we be baptized by immersion for the remission of sins. That's not my opinion, guys. I know the religious world says, just believe in Jesus and you'll go to heaven. Do you believe Jesus? Do you believe His words inspired? Mark 16, 16, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Who are you going to believe? You're going to believe man? You're going to believe the Bible. Those that were baptized, they were added to the church, Acts 2, 47. Man doesn't add you to this church. God adds you to this church. The Lord adds you to this church. He knows whether you've obeyed the gospel, and He adds you to this church. It's not a denomination. We have no earthly headquarters anywhere. This congregation simply is a group of Christians that meet together and do what the Bible says. And you know why we're a first century New Testament church? Because that's how we live. And if you want to be part of that, all you need to do is do what they did in the first century. Hear the gospel, believe it, repent, confess the name of Christ, and be baptized. And if you're a Christian and you've done that, ask yourself, do I have a clean conscience? Do I understand what the will of God is, and am I living according to it? Remember what Jesus said? I'll summarize with this. You best check yourself. If you got a problem, 1 John 1, 7 through 9, repent, turn from it, just be faithful. And as we talked about this morning in Bible study, He won't remember it anymore. But you've got to do what He's told us to do. We love you. We don't want anyone to leave here in an unrighteous position. So if we can help you, you can come forward as we stand and sing a song of invitation.